get into a dialogue with them. So that's why we have this beautiful flip chart. So the first part of the talk, we will tackle the question, what is art?
Yes.
Something like that. And then, then we'll introduce the magazine and also talk about his works.
Yeah.
Great, so.
Great, thank you very much.
Welcome, Dan.
Hello, everybody. Hi. Okay, I haven't done this lecture for a few years, actually. I was an art tutor, and I got sacked. So you might find out why. So, sorry about that. You're all art students, yeah? And what is it called here? Like, specifically, is it fine art? Do you call it fine art here?
Who wants to?
Yeah. That's the master's name.
Hmm?
That's the master's name.
The master's is the level, but what is actually the subject?
So there's like a department, art and media, and then within the department you have four specializations.
Right. And do you have this thing called fine art?
Yeah, so there's a master in fine art.
Right, okay. So I'm only interested in fine art. You know, photography is nice, but it's relatively easy. And sorry if you're a photographer. I'm joking. Look, oh my God. Okay. Well, it's not easy, but it's actually really hard, but, you know. So, for those of you studying fine art, do you understand? You only know what the art bit is. So what does the fine bit mean? Does anybody know? You're studying fine art, what does it actually mean?
For refined and intellectual people.
Pardon?
For refined and intellectual people.
No. Very few people actually know what it means. It means finished. I don't know why it's called that, but it is. Maybe it's a historical thing and we just latch onto it. Anyway. So you're studying art, okay, and most of you want to be artists or already are. I mean, the funny thing about art education, you're as much of an artist when you walked in this building on the first day of school as you will be when you finished, right? No one can actually teach you to be an artist. You either are or you're not, right? You either are an artist or you're not. I mean, you could fuck around with it if you like and dibble dabble, but, you know, like, to be a serious artist, you know, that happened to you maybe when you were born or something, or somewhere down the line as a child or whatever. So coming here isn't going to really make you, like, more of an artist. You might learn some stuff, which is probably kind of good considering you're in a school, but I don't know if it's going to make you more of an artist as such. Anyway, okay. So you're an artist, you are artists, and you're studying art. So, you can do that, look. Ooh, it's just time. So I'm just joking. We had a joke earlier about timing. I can keep it open, it's okay. It makes it easier for people to run away. So what is art? It's a question for you. What is art? Anybody?
A point of view on society?
Yeah, but you could get that in a newspaper.
But it's
a commentator could make that.
Yes, but it's more a personal sort of mind on a situation.
Yeah, but that's not really saying what it is. Like, because lots of things could do that.
Well, it's you, it's me, it's him, it's
me,
us.
Me, it's you.
Yeah.
Is it?
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't think so.
Well, you tell me what it is.
I'm going to. That's, you know. Anybody else? Just like some ideas, like what is it? Like, is it a feeling? Do you feel it? Do you think it? Does it have to be a physical thing? You know, is it something that, you know, is it about money? Is it about making a living? Is it a spiritual thing? Is it something that you absolutely can't do without?
Expression.
It's an expression. Okay, that's an expression. Okay, it's an expression. Expression of what?
Extreme obsession.
Pardon?
Extreme obsession.
Okay, yeah, it's kind of seems to be useful to be fairly obsessive if you're going to be an artist. Although, like, I'm a very obsessive person. I used to be a drug addict, and I haven't used drugs for a long time. I don't use drugs anymore, but I used to use a lot. And I was obsessed with drugs. And it just, what it, my experience with that meant was I could not help myself but think about it. there wasn't any work involved in being obsessive, right? I don't know if you've ever had an obsessive ex-girlfriend or ex-boyfriend who's Facebooked the shit out of you and phoned you up and stalked you. You know, they don't love you because they're doing something that really is horrible. But, you know, they think they love you. Do you see what I mean? So I agree, I like obsession, but I don't know. Okay. I might need a volunteer in a minute. Got one, right? They're beautiful, they're amazing. You know about the brain, it's incredibly complicated. There's more connections in the brain than there are bits of the universe, apparently. Which is kind of quite So if we were to cut off your arms and your legs and essentially get rid of as much as possible, we'll be left with that. Right? That's easily the most important part of you. Yes? Mm-hmm. It's hard to argue that it isn't. I mean, you know, I'm sure you're very attached to your hands and your genitals. Probably in combination with each other. I don't know if any of you read this. This is Susan Sontag. It's George Bataille's Story of the Eye. George Bataille, however you pronounce it. Story of the Eye. It's a great sort of teeny book to read. It's quite shocking. But at the back of the, for as long as I've known it, in the Penguin edition, is an essay by Susan Sontag. You can find this online, but not as text. It's only as a scanned PDF. So you can find it. You don't have to buy the book. And the essay is called The Pornographic Imagination. So I'm just going to read. And basically, she's trying to make an argument in this. She successfully makes an argument, I should say, about, what... She's talking about literature, but she's talking about what artists do, because this story is undoubtedly art, but was heavily criticized because it was kind of straying into obsessive, abnormal behavior, to say the least. If you haven't read it, it's really worth reading. It's very funny. So, if within the last century, art conceived as an autonomous activity has come to be invested with an unprecedented... If, she's asking a question, if within the last century, art conceived as an autonomous activity has come to be invested with an unprecedented stature. So art's been given this thing, okay, in the 20th century. This was probably written in 1964. So modern art has happened, and it's become quite clear that art has been, it's moved from one thing to another, okay? So what art used to be pre-20th century and what it became, very different. Do you understand that? Does that being pointed out to you know that, right? It's kind of quite obvious. That makes sense. Do you understand why? Like art was something, it did something, and then it became something else. Okay, so if we got a time machine and we went back a couple hundred years, if you wanted to see an image, there was no photography, if you wanted to see an image, yeah, maybe you could make one at home, like out of the blood of an animal or something or whatever. But you, in London, for example, you used to be able to pay a very, very, very small amount of money and go to a tent and there'd be some prints and paintings on the wall. Or maybe if you could read, you could find in the newspaper there might be some kind of image, but fairly rare 100 years ago. But it was, you know, you could buy prints, penny prints. There's a great artist called Hogarth who used to make quite a lot of money by, he'd make prints, etchings of his paintings. My point is that the further back you go, the more rarefied this becomes. And what that is about is that art had power. So if you were to go back, 1700, 1600, 1500, and you were, is anybody here really rich? Anyone come from a really rich family? Like really rich? Anyone here got millionaire parents? You're not gonna put your hands up because the rest of the guys here are gonna fucking hate you. But this is Switzerland, so the chances are there's at least 10 of you in here who are like really fucking rich, yeah? But no one's gonna admit it. Oh my God, okay. I'm not really rich. So if we went back a few hundred years, I'd probably get born in a field, and then once a week I'd go to church because like churches were really groovy. Like everything, the whole world is kind of like black and white, and you go to church, it's an amazing color. And churches used to be painted, and they used to sing out of them. So as you walk to church, you'd see brightly painted things that sing at you. And also you're not eating very well, so you're beginning to hallucinate because you're not getting enough vitamins. So going to church was a really fucking amazing experience. You know, house music is nothing new. You know, getting fucked up in a nightclub, it kind of was the same. Anyway, but you'd see all these stained glass windows and paintings. It was art. Art had power. It told a story. But then this stopped because of film and television and radio and mass media. That's why you look like you do, right? Okay? Like you're not, like artists are kind of weird, always have been, Van Gogh, whatever. Rembrandt was pretty crazy. Leonardo was fucking nuts. But it had this function that it no longer has anymore. So one of the things art had to do was like to, you know, and this is why when you look at art criticism, it's almost meaningless now, because there's no power involved, and they're still trying to negotiate what it's about. Anyway, so, the 20th century needed to invest something into art, is basically what she's saying. So, the nearest thing to, so art, an artist, the nearest thing to a sacramental human activity acknowledged by secular society. So we've kicked religion away. Well, that's not quite true. This, Switzerland, Sweden, France, Germany, Western Europe are Christian countries, okay? They just don't have, God has been kicked out of the middle. It's been replaced by yourself and shopping and celebrity and sex and money and status, okay? I'm not saying anything that's particularly new. That's quite an obvious idea. Sorry about that, though, if you're upset. You can still find God. He's deeper than you. I'm not joking. Okay. So, it is because one of the tasks art has assumed is making forays, little journeys, into and taking up positions on the frontiers of consciousness. Okay. So somewhere in here is your mind. Medical science can't really tell you where it is. We don't really know. But we know it's there, right? You are all, like, I don't know about you, my thinking never stops. It's a constant stream, and it fucking irritates me sometimes. But, do you know what I mean? Like, you're probably thinking something, you are thinking, probably. You're constantly thinking, yes? And that happens in the mind, obviously. I'm sorry this is a bit, if I'm pitching this too low, just say, stop patronizing me. But so in here is thinking in the mind, but we don't know where, right? I mean, we know more about our thinking when you damage the structure of the brain than doing MRI scans. So if you hit someone with a hammer, or they can't remember whatever, there was a great story about this girl who got bashed on the head. And then she became a total savant. I can't remember, physics or maths or something. Like she suddenly, like ping, oh, I know how to multiply 25 billion by, you know. So it's a difficult thing. But they know where, and there's memory in here somewhere. And like the one of the best bits of the brain is called the midbrain. Anyone that ever studied the midbrain? Anyone drink alcohol? Put your hand up if you drink alcohol. Come on. Okay, so when you drink alcohol or you inject cocaine or heroin, which is what I used to like doing, but there's this bit in your brain. Sorry, I'm going to go all over the place, I don't even care. So right in the middle, somewhere like there, is this thing called the midbrain. And essentially, All animals have this. All animals have a midbrain. So you are animals, you have a midbrain. And what the midbrain does, it's a mechanism of survival. So what it's interested in is the next 15 seconds. It's awake now in you, you're not aware of it, but it's looking at the next 15 seconds. And it's looking for three things: food, sex, and violence. Okay? And when you look at animals, that's what they're about. So when you look at a dog, it's constantly going, right? And it's kind of, where's the good stuff, right? Where can I get something to eat? Where can I get something to fuck? And is there some dude around who's going to threaten my shit that I've got to go and bite, right? Now the thing is, look, these three things are pleasurable. Society has socialized out of you the fact that violence is pleasurable, okay? It is. Sex is pleasurable, right? Food is the number one instinct you've got. Putting something in your mouth comes first, right? In order for animals to survive, nature / God made the fundamentals pleasurable. Because if they weren't, you wouldn't do it. So if you're starving to death, and I've got a great big chocolate cake or some broccoli, you're going to go for this, because instinctively you know it's got more calories. Putting calories in your mouth equals pleasure, right? Okay. So, wonderful brain. So your thinking is in there somewhere, and it is kind of like dominated by this. So when you drink alcohol, that's where it goes. They used to think, the curly bit here that animals don't really have, the cerebral cortex, right, where you do all this thinking, we suppose, right? Animals don't have that. Dolphins have got it, but I don't think they've got very much to think about because they just swim around in the sea all day long. But this is important. It radiates out. So when you drink alcohol, you do whatever drugs or whatever, or you get some kind of pleasure, this sends signals to the curly bit. That was great, do it again. Okay. So, that's a segue, actually, so I apologize. So somewhere in here is a mind, and kind of art's important, right? It's connected to the mind. So what influences the mind? What influences art? So let's try and build a list of the things that influence you as an artist. And then we'll get down the road a little bit with what art is. Okay, so I'm going to need you to participate a little bit. So what influences you? What influences your mind, your thinking, right?
Context. Context, what surrounds us.
What surrounds you? We'll call that the environment. Mm. Okay. I can't spell for shit, so... environment. What else?
Aesthetic.
Aesthetics? Mm-hmm. Should we call that beauty?
No.
Aesthetics,
whatever.
Aesthetics, with your eyes?
Yeah, or mouth, or finger.
Yeah, okay. How do you spell aesthetics?
With a TH.
Yes. Okay. What else?
Philosophy.
Philosophy, okay. So I think philosophy, we'll just put that high-level thinking. Well, no, wait a minute. It's not your high-level thinking, although that's important.
Maybe conception is the other one.
We'll just call that information. Okay. So that's, info is everything. Like text, film, whatever. Outside stimulus of philosophical things. So what else?
Music,
that's an info.
Experience.
Yes. Some experience. But I can't spell experience at all. Okay. What else?
Pleasure.
That's in aesthetics.
Feelings.
Feelings. What comes first, thought or feelings?
Pain.
Pain, did you say? Who said pain? Well, the two biggest influences in your life are fear and pain, no doubt about it. But yeah, so feelings. Anything else? What this brain of yours,
body.
The body, yes. And the body, oh my God, the body. Love the body.
I have a question, why is environment not information?
It could strictly be, but an earthquake is not necessarily information, but it's gonna, right?
Experience.
So nature, you could say nature.
Right.
Experience, got that?
Curiosity.
I'm sorry, I don't mean to bore you. I feel so bad you're leaving. Right.
Social interaction.
Society. Each other. Big one. Big one. Absolutely. And what else?
Spirit.
Spirit. God.
Yeah.
Okay.
Maybe.
Yes. Let's have a nice bit of God somewhere. God. Okay. Anything else? I think we're missing the biggest one.
Drug abuse goes under experience.
Or information.
Oh.
Imagine. Oh no. Okay. No. Let's. I think that. I think that. No. I think that's a very important one. Actually, it's very, very, very important. We'll just call it chems, right? Okay. Anything else? There's the big one still not in there.
Money.
Huh?
Money.
What?
Money.
Money? Yeah. No. Actually, yeah. I list them. Dollars. Because only because art is priced in dollars.
Vision?
Information. Right. Okay, now I'll come.
Oneself. Like
what?
Oneself. The
what
I.
Do you mean?
I.
Well, no. Yes, but what do you mean? You're on the right track. Hmm?
Reason.
No.
Consciousness.
No.
Ego.
No.
Imagination.
No.
Ego.
No. Jesus. So when you take identical twins and you separate them at birth and you take one and put them in Australia and the other one you put them in Mexico and you bring them up under completely different situations, they don't speak to each other for 40 years and then they meet and they look at each other, it's amazing the decisions they make are the same. They've sought out similar looking women with the same name, they've got the same pet, they've got the same hobbies, they've built the same fence around the same tree in their back garden, they organise their tools in the same way. Not always true, but more often than not. A lot of the information about this gets suppressed because people don't like it. It's not very nice. It has some rather unpleasant historical precedents, which are obviously evil. But, okay, so, where was I? Oh, yeah. So, taking up position on the frontiers of so this artist, the artist, she is taking up positions on the frontiers of consciousness. So, in this consciousness, we're looking for a frontier somewhere. Because, like, there's absolutely no point in having the same thought someone had 10 years ago, right? And going, hey, listen, I'm going to sort of like, what I want to do is get some sharks and put them in some liquid in a big tank. What do you think? It's like, yeah, somebody's already done that, you know. Or I'm going to paint some sunflowers in this really gloopy paint. It's, yeah. And you could do it in an ironic way, but only one person could do that. So, you're taking up positions on the frontiers of consciousness, often very dangerous to the artist as a person. There's a warning, by the way, being an artist is not necessarily good for your health. And I really mean that. So you're going into you're breaking new ground into human consciousness and you're reporting back what you find. That's kind of the job description. So being a freelance explorer of spiritual dangers, the artist gains a certain license to behave differently from other people. So if you want to take a shit on the floor at your grandmother's house and say it's art, you can do that, right? And, oh, that's a bit bad, but you can get away with it, okay? So you can do all these weird things, you can be quite unpleasant, you can embrace your ego and all these things, and not really care too much about what people think about you. So that's kind of historically proven. Like, a lot of artists are pretty unpleasant. My friends are. I love them, don't they? So, Her job is inventing trophies of her experience, objects and gestures that fascinate and enthrall. Wait a minute. Okay. Yeah, let's, is that viewable? Kind of is. Sorry if I'm a bit retarded at this. I think it goes like that. Oh wow, that was amazing. How the fuck did that? That was really cool. Thank you. Whoever did that. That was really well done. Okay. So this is a trophy. Okay, when you win something, I need a volunteer, please, just quickly. You'll do. So, what's your name?
Benjamin.
Benjamin, hello, I'm Dan. Hi. So inside Benjamin's skull is his brain, which is where the art happens. Yes? Okay, it's informed by your body, your DNA, all of these wonderful things, but it's going on in there. Yes?
Yeah.
You love your brain.
Yeah, I do.
Fantastic, okay. Now, if Benjamin didn't do anything, and we wanted to experience, his art, well, what would we do? I mean, we'd have to sort of smash his skull open, find the bit of his brain that's had this amazing idea. And it's probably about that big. And if you put it on the wall, it would look like a little smudge of grease or something, right? So, unfortunately, Benjamin would be dead or extremely disabled. And I would go to prison for damaging you, which obviously is not going to happen. Thank you very much. Okay. So what Benjamin does, it's very difficult to sort of like roll everything into one. It's not a good idea. It's kind of the amateur does that. The amateur artist tries to pack everything in, the fear of open space. So we kind of like try to be a little bit strategic about it, and we kind of try to get something across. And that's what art is. It's one of these. It's a trophy of all of this, all of your experience, when you are foraging, when you're exploring this consciousness that you've got, you've been given, that's obviously informed by, you know, this and myriad other things, politics, food, sex, religion, whatever. That's it, right? So the art is a representation of the journey, the spiritual journey, the intellectual, the journey of into your consciousness. Essentially what you're looking for, the interesting thing about this that I think, at least anyway from my point of view, is that when you're doing this, like, you are going into your mind, your brain, whatever, and you're pushing basically forward in humanity, right? And you're finding this thing, but it's not crazy, crazy, crazy. When you pull it out, it's brand new, but everyone else can recognize it, right? Or they have a sense with it, okay? It's not like it's sort of, oh, I don't understand it. It's difficult to fully understand, but when you sort of trust yourself and you're honest with yourself, when you look at a piece of art, there's something there that you can, I mean, that's one of the reasons why I really love art is that, you know, I see a piece of art and I know instantly whether I like it or not. Right? It's kind of, yeah, there's something, and then I want to interrogate it. I'm drawn in. And that can also act as a repulsion. There's a great story about Leo Castelli, who's a gallerist, and a famous gallerist in New York. And he was walking down Broadway, and he saw this little gallery, and there's all these paintings in the window. And he's just like thinking, what the fuck? This is shit. This is the worst. And he goes home, and he's ranting to his wife, his partner. Yeah, I saw this terrible exhibition today. This absolutely the worst painting I have ever seen. And he goes to bed, and then he wakes up, and then he goes to the gallery next day, and he buys the lot. And it was Cy Twombly. It was one of. I'm not a fan of Cy Twombly. but it's one of these things, you know, like, oh my god, it's horrible. And that's because there's something else psychologically going on with me when I do that, and actually have to go back and revisit. So, but sometimes I can mistake this for a lump of shit or something. Okay, but that's kind of where I'm coming from with this. And you know, it's a bit of a generalized thing to say. And you know, as I said, I hope I haven't. You know, I don't want to talk down to you because you're all like super smart or something. At least you've got a very smart building. So, okay, so. So I went to art school, and it was shit. And but it was in the 80s, and I didn't have a good time there. I don't know, I had a great time, but I didn't really learn anything. The tutors weren't very good. They were all kind of alcoholically insane. They were far too upset with the fact that their career had stalled, so they had to make money teaching art. So you've got to be careful about your tutors. They can be really quite damaged and damaging people. Okay, so you just forgive them. But they've had their go, you haven't. But there are some that are really good. I hope I'm one of those, but I might not be. I did get sacked, as I said, so. Okay, so I went to art school, it was shit, and it was the 80s, and there were sort of a couple of options. You either went to Germany, that's still kind of quite trendy, isn't it? Like, how do you boost your art career? You move to Berlin, right? I mean, if you don't, you know, are there loads of collectors coming here? I mean, sure, it's pretty cool. Berlin, wow. But it wasn't Berlin then, it was Cologne. Back in the early 90s, it was Cologne was the center of the art world, in European terms at least anyway. And, you know, like, some of my friends moved there, and I got involved in a project. I sort of went out there for a while, and because otherwise you have to try, like, to find, like, being a young artist trying to become an assistant for another artist, which is another way of positioning yourself. But back in like early 90s, that was really difficult to do. There wasn't really an art world as such. I mean, the YBAs were coming along, but they were sort of like, ugh. You could go and do an MA, but I didn't want to do an MA. And then you set up a studio, and that was kind of like so boring. I really didn't like it very much. Anyway, so then what happened was, so this might look like I'm massively unprepared, but I'm not. And it's, I think it's that. Okay. Oh yeah, that's, sorry. Oops. But it's kind of true though. Ooh, how do you stop doing that? Stop it. Okay. So, this is a big room in the middle of London, and this was my studio, along with that bit. That's the front view. So this is right in the center of London. Anyone been to London? Anyone been to London? Like Tottenham Court Road, that was next door to Tottenham Court Road, so it's right in the middle. So this is where I got this really cheap. This is when you could do that, you can't do that anymore. And so this is 1993. And a couple of my friends had moved back from Cologne, and they had been assistants for Kippenberger and Uhlen and Richter. And so they were kind of quite glamorous and they knew a lot. And so we decided to start this thing called Poster Studio. Now, first things first, just don't take any photographs or anything I'm about to show you for the next 5 minutes. Just don't, please. Oh, is the video camera, is that on?
Oh yeah, it's on. But it's for the archive. We can pause it.
Yeah,
can we pause it, please? It was a very interesting thing. You can turn the camera back on, please. So it was a very interesting revelation for me to be able to look back and think, oh yeah, like I felt I suffered. I went to art school thinking, gosh, I did a foundation course and I went to art school thinking, oh my God, it's going to be great. And it was shit. It just, you know, like, no, you can't do that and you can't do this. That's crap. This is no good. Don't do that. And, you know, it was just, you know, maybe it's just where I went or whatever. It just didn't work out very well. I mean, I did okay. You know, they gave me a first degree or whatever, but you know, I don't know what that means, but so I got some instruction from that. Also, there's a website you might want to look at. It's called Society of Control. It's a website. Do you know Stefan Dillermuth? Yes? Does he ring a bell? Worth checking out. Just had a show at Rena Spalding's. Which looked really good, actually. But he ran this thing called Friesenbar 120, and the model for that is what we used to make Poster Studio from. So it was kind of like, you know, he's 10 years older than me, so it was like, I met him, and it was like, oh my God, you know, like, you're doing these things, this is fucking amazing. And like, oh, it's possible to make art like this, it's possible to be like this, it's possible to not follow what everyone else is doing, not follow the sort of like, oh, I'm gonna put a stick in the corner and there's a video screen over there and there's a plant pot, I'll just kick that over. You know, like, oh, like post-internet or whatever. Like, actually, no, you've gotta be honest, you've gotta do what's inside of you, you've gotta, you know, this stuff here, it's important. You know, if you're gonna sort of explore things, then you need to, I think it has to be a genuine exploration. Anyway, so one of the things that came out of this poster studio thing was just like, started making quite a lot of collage, but just as a joke. Like, we used to send fax, before the email, there was this thing called a fax machine, where you got a piece of paper and you fed it into a machine, and this amazing thing happened, is like, across the other side of the world, another piece of paper would look exactly like your piece of paper, would come out. So we used to make these collages, and this guy, Stefan Dillemann, we used to bomb him, and like, just like, make stupid drawings or collages of, you know, like, you eat rats or whatever, you know. And like, we found this thing where we got an image of a rat, and we put it into the fax machine, and then we held it so it couldn't move. We fed it through really slowly. But at the other end, he had one of those fax machines with a roll. So this roll, this rat just went and he was like, the next day, like, you fucking assholes, you just used up a whole roll on a rat. But and then he started sending us faxes of how to commit suicide, like, really sort of like poor, bad, like, how to hang yourself under a chair, or, you know. So it was kind of, it was quite tough, but it was really good fun. So I started making collage, and then what happened was, kind of, things got a bit fucked up, to be honest with you. Kind of want to show you Hard Mag now, but I said I was going to talk about that later. But, oh no, wait a minute, wait, let me have a look at this. I mean, there's so much here I could show you. I'm aware that you have other lives to engage with. So this is an example of these collages that were made with Stefan Dillemann, Merlin Carpenter, and myself. And so it was kind of like, we got asked to be in this show about, it was at the Drawing Center in New York, about faxes, and this was like about 7 years ago. So it was like, oh, let's go back to the 90s, because the 90s is cool. If you didn't know, by the way, the 90s is cool, if you didn't know. And so we just made all these stupid collage faxes, Matthew Higgs. So we just made all these stupid faxes and then sent them to this New York gallery. And we sort of we emailed them back and forth towards each other. And then they got faxed off. So it just, you know, it's kind of quite rude to the people who've asked us to be in it. And so this is, Liam Gillick keeps cropping up. So these are quotes from Liam Gillick. And Matthew Higgs, you know who Matthew Higgs is?
Yeah.
He's a really big curator in New York, he's really powerful. And I think he wants to be Hans Zurich Oberist, but kind of a bigger one. Yeah, it's just kind of funny. So let's fax, let's fuck off. It's just, this has now become, this other thing, I guess you could say, that this is important. So you've got to have lols. So a lot of this, lols are really important. If you don't have lols, then it gets really boring. So there's, you know, a lot, although you can be very, very serious with art, I don't know, I think it's really important to be able to sort of find a joke in it. So yeah, we made these faxes, and you can see they're pretty ugly, pretty stupid. Sort of echoing back to Nicholas Beaurard, who's a 90s figure, giving some context to whoever said context being important. So they're really totally stupid. I mean, these are really bad, right? I hope they're really bad. I click on that, is that going to screw everything up? Or does that just take their thing away? Does anybody know? This thing here is really irritating.
Put the cursor on the side.
Huh?
Put the cursor, move the cursor at the side of
the... And unclick.
Oh, genius, okay. Yeah, sorry, I'm retarded. I'm retarded. You can't say that, can you? You're very politically correct here, so if I say things like that, because this is going to get really bad. There's stuff that I definitely am not going to show you, because I've got to do studio visits and I need to get paid, so I just say, you're beautiful. So that's Liam Gillick about to shoot Damien Hirst. Because the story is Liam Gillick drove Damien Hirst to the warehouse where they had the Freeze exhibition, but didn't go in. They wouldn't let him in. So that's quite funny. But you know, Liam shouldn't be jealous. He's got a nice career. If you like being a boring... Oh, look, there he is again as police. I don't know why. We just did it. So, okay. Oops, sorry about that. Really sorry about that. Whoops, I don't know how I got it. Where's the camera? There it is. Okay, so. Okay, so why don't we just go, why don't we randomize some things here? Okay, let's. Oh, yeah, all right, these are fun. So let's bring things up to date. It's getting really good now, you shouldn't leave. Is he coming back?
Yeah, just going for some beers.
Going for some beers?
Yeah.
Whoa! Oh, come on. Why is what? Okay. Right, okay, good. So, I did this show. This friend of mine, a guy from Richard Sides, had this house that he lived in, and it was a kind of like office space. Whoa, come on, Jesus Christ, go back. Stop. So he asked me to do a show. Do any of you know Richard Sides? Check him out, very good artist. Richard Sides. Anyway, so he asked me to do this show we named the space. We argued, well, we had a conversation about what we'd call the space. Like, you know, we wanted it to be really big. Like, gallery universe was quite big. But it wasn't big enough. So we ended up going for gallery god, which sounds better. G, gallery god. So we invented this new gallery, which we'll do something again soon, hopefully. Gallery god. And these are the images from the show that I made. And so my collaging has got a little bit more sophisticated from when I started in the 90s to this is December 2014. Anyway, so, yeah. So apparently some of you are quite into this, the theory of the young girl. There's a reading group or something. Yes, does that make sense? People know what we're talking about? Ultra left, French theory, invisible committee, tech in, yes? Make sense? No? If you don't know about it, it's worth reading. Are you all really like, oh, I've read this 10 times, or what? Can I say something, please? It's really difficult. You know? Like, do you know this?
It's a pain in the ass.
It's a pain in the ass?
Yes.
Why?
There are certain assumptions reliant on the idea of the young girl that are perhaps more multigendered than them, but that's a whole other story.
Yes, I wouldn't disagree with you. I like these guys' work in the sense that it's kind of funny to read. I like it like poetry or something, or a novel. And I think some of the things they point at, from my experience, somewhere in the brain thing over there, my experience, damn, it's true. I'm going to leap around a little bit. I want to go back to this thing. Let me finish reading this. Trophies of experience, objects, la 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 la. Prince all means a fascination in is to advance one step further in. Hold on, sorry, I don't want to lose you. He seeks to make artwork that is repulsive, obscure, inaccessible. In short, give what is or seems to be not wanted. But however fierce may be the outrages, the artist perpetuates upon his or her audience the credentials and spiritual authority ultimately that ultimately depend on the audience's sense, whether something known or inferred, of the outrage she commits upon herself. The exemplary artists, that doesn't make very much sense, but the point is this. The exemplary modern artist is a broker in madness. Susan Sontag then goes on to say, the notion of art as the dearly purchased outcome of an immense spiritual risk, basically saying you are going to get paid as artists because you've taken some risks. Right? Now, you might say, hey, well, we're not going to sell art in galleries. We're going to get together the community, invent our own economy. That's really great. That poster studio thing was very much... We didn't go to anyone for any money. We made the money. Well, I made the money by renting out the space for a crazy nightclub, right? So you can make quite a lot of money renting this out, open a party here, 3 o'clock Saturday morning, going on till 12 midday. Over there are some really wicked drugs that you can buy. And then over there, there's a DJ that's going to play some really fucking good music. And we might put a red light bulb up or something. And we'll charge you... How much does it cost to go to a nightclub here? How many Swiss francs?
10 and 25.
10 and 25. It's 50 to get in here. It's going to be great. And you would make, you know, quite a lot of money. And then you could then fund your art career or art practice out of that. If you got together, find a squat, put on parties. I mean, that's nothing new, right? I mean, we were doing that in the 90s and there was nothing new about that then. But it, you know, kind of like how the one of the things I want to try and get to is about this idea of economy as an artist, right? So, like, for people who will not identify themselves as rich and never having to work another day in their lives, it's fantastic, it's great for you. I'm not particularly envious, whatever, you know what I mean? But it's, you know, privilege is a good thing in some ways, well, kind of isn't as well. But, so, like, how are you going to make, like, am I the oldest person in this room? I'm 48. Anyone actually ever had a job? Like, you went to school and, like, your parents paid for everything, and then you got to about the age of 20 and you sort of made a decision about going to art school and you're in art school. But so, I mean, some of you have got jobs, but, like, it fucking hurts, right, having a job. I'm 48. If I go out into the job market and say, hi, can you give me a job? I end up being told what to do by somebody like you. Right? And I'm telling you, that hurts. Oh, you're 25. Hi, Dan, can you just go and photocopy that and don't make any mistakes this time, okay? And don't take too long in the toilet and don't, and you're wearing trainers to work again, okay? It's annihilating. So the economy is important. So, like, has anyone ever been to an art fair, like FIAC or Frieze or Basel or Miami, whatever? Ever been to an art fair?
Yes.
Yeah, what do you think about that?
Shit.
Why is it shit?
Well, there's so many people, so many works of art, so many galleries, so many business going on, so many words, so many...
Yeah, but it's a big world.
Yeah, but it's not exciting. It's a big world.
It doesn't have to be exciting, but...
Of sort of buzzement of your
things. You could get paid.
Well, pay me then.
I'm not going to pay you. I'm not rich. But, like, you could sell your work at an art fair, right? Could do. Happens. I mean, I'm just saying that... It's, you know, I'm not saying think about it in terms of being a careerist, but kind of like, you know, the idea that, oh, you can make art on the side and go and get this other job, yeah, it kind of doesn't work out. It didn't work out for me, just like, poof. Maybe it's easy to do that in Switzerland, I don't know. Maybe the government will give you money, just like, you turn up to the government office somewhere that just says ideas for cash, and you turn up and you go, yeah, like, hello. I've been to Berlin and, like, I have an idea, yeah, and, like, can I have some Swiss francs from you, yeah, because it's going to be cool. And maybe they just give you some money, I don't know. I don't think so, right? Then you'll be standing outside going, fuck you dicks anyway, right? Okay. So you have to think about this. It's all very well making positions and saying, you know, fuck you, and fuck you, and this is shit, and this is wrong. Doesn't always work out. I know, I'm the proof of this. So, wait a minute. The notion of art as a dearly purchased outcome of immense spiritual risk, one whose cost goes up with the entry and participation of each new player. That's really interesting. So you make art, and then each person in the game who comes along the price changes, the involvement changes. So, like, oh, I'm, hey, hello, my name's Hans, I want to curate to work in this show. And so then it, somebody else comes along, the gallery, they come in, the other people come in, the collectors come in, and each participant pushes it up. So you might sell your thing for 1,000, they take it a fee, 5,000, next level, 10,000. Do you see what I'm saying? So there is this kind of deal going on, and it's difficult. There was a new report written by this Australian that was published in Germany, it's now in English. He sent emails out to 8,000 galleries around the world and did a survey and got 6,000 responses, which is really quite a lot. And he asked them about their expenses and across the world, analysed the art world from an art gallery's point of view, and he came up with one very important conclusion. And that is that the deal between galleries and artists is wrong. It is wrong, it is far too favourable to the artist. The classic 50-50 split is incorrect, and actually, when you take all the considerations of fixed costs and capital increases, 70% goes to the gallery, the artist gets 30%. That's the fairer deal. So watch out. Well, I know, that science says that. Okay, so gallery god, and so I'm using sort of like, I wrote these lines, trend betrayal management. So this is one of these things that's kind of informed by the ultra-left theory, which I really like, I don't necessarily believe in it. I don't care. I mean, like, you know, whatever, politics, blah, blah, blah. But yes, I do care. You know, like, the spectacle is something that is crushing. You know about the spectacle? So, Guy Debord?
Yeah.
You know, it's interesting. Guy Debord, in the Society of the Spectacle, Guy Debord actually comes up with... So, like, you cannot avoid the spectacle, right? It is all around you. You are part of it. You've invested in it. It's invested in you. It's why you wear Adidas, you know, the Adidas gang here. Triangle, okay? So, and there's the Nike people who don't really come into this very much. There's the New Balance, which I'm still trying to work out what that means. But it tends to be, I don't know, it's got something particular to it. I like it, it's nice. Okay, where was I? Yeah, the spectacle. And anyway, so you've got this thing called the spectacle. And yeah, I believe in it 100%, and I think, it, one way of accessing the power of the spectacle empire and biopower is to read books like this. I think The Invisible Committee, The Coming Insurrection, and To Our Friends, possibly more illustrative, but I kind of like this just because it's sort of retarded. But I acknowledge the problems that it's got. The kind of initial criticism of it was problematic, but I still think it's right. Well, I'm just saying it's reflective. Anyway, okay. So this was a combination of some pornography that I found in this weird shop, and these kind of like images of film posters. So trend betrayal management. You can't betray the trend. You mustn't betray the trend. And a lot of the people who have these sort of mini bureaucratic jobs that have then filtered into you, you are becoming a policeman of trend. Don't betray the trend. It's how the spectacle works. So when I left art school...
Risk? What about the risk you take on art?
Well, we'll get to that. Okay. Write that down as a question and ask me later. Okay, where was I? So you interrupted the flow, dude. Trend betrayal management.
Can't go against the trend.
Don't go against the trend. Okay, all right, yeah. So when I left art school, right, you could walk into an agency and just go, I want a job, I can drive. And they'd go, okay, then go to this depot tomorrow and you're driving a van for the local authority. Like that. Ooh. Whereas today, you'd have to give a CV, fill out an application form, have an interview, and in this interview, you would have to show the person who's interviewing you that you are willing to invest your ability to form intimate human relationships as part of being a van driver, because it's customer service. You might meet a member of the public and you have to represent the company in such a profound way that they think, oh my God, DHL, fucking hell, they're amazing. Right? Essentially is what it comes down to. So the capitalism, in order to expand and find a new territory has found that territory inside of you. Okay? That's what this is about, essentially. So it used to be that you could just, you know, you go to this surplus value labour exchange deal. That's not good enough anymore. You have to be able to sell your and professionalize yourself deeper down. So the tentacles of this evil empire have found new ways to make money, and that, no surprise, that's the internet is brilliant at doing that. So Facebook is utter genius. So you will die as a child. Bit of transvesticism, transgender, sorry. Chicks with dicks. Fantastic. So these are quite abhorrent, right? Cool, weird, void. I noticed that a lot of my younger friends, like we were doing this show, and they were making decisions about how something would be arranged. And the two words that had value were, if a good thing happened, that was cool. If it was a bad thing, it was weird. Right? So just all I heard was like, yeah, cool, weird. And if anything I did was weird, just that went over there. And I was like, oh, okay, that's fucked up. So I thought we were supposed to be weird here, not cool all the time. So. But anyway, so that's, the film is called
Spring Breakers.
Fucking great movie. If you haven't seen it, you should go and see it. It's absolutely awesome.
Really?
I loved it. It's great. It's really, really good.
You have to see it in the cinema.
Yeah, and it's the colour is so good. they are creeping around inside of you. So this actually a better film, which is hard because I think Spring Breakers was very, very good. Actually, Nightcrawler, really, you've all seen it, right?
No.
What the fuck is wrong with you? You're an arse. You're not watching movies?
It's not Spring Break because I haven't seen Nightcrawler.
Oh, you've got to see Nightcrawler, dude.
Someone told me it's dead, so that's...
And so you believe them?
I don't know.
They were trying to destroy your art career by stopping you see this, right?
Okay.
They're enemies.
Okay.
That's trend betrayal management right there.
Okay.
Oh, don't go and see that. Okay? See what happens? Right. So, and they are real, and they are, you know, they're in your mind. They look through your eyes. Okay? Dark Mind Details. It's 2001. American Psycho. The poster for the show. Oh, no, that's the poster for the gallery. Yes, that's the poster for the gallery, sorry.
What was the image?
That is, I forgot her name now, but she is being chased by Christian Bale down the corridor in American Psycho. Poison Gas was the name of the show. So Poison Gas is an idea. So W.P. Thompson was an advertising executive, very, 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 very successful. And in his agency, he gave these kind of talks every now and again, and he got all his advertising executives together, and he said, what do we do here? What is advertising? And they were like, oh, well, you know, it's a way of sophisticatedly marketing a product. And I was like, fucking shut the fuck up. Come on, it's ridiculous. And he said, advertising at its best is poison gas because it takes your breath away. When you see an amazing thing, you go, it steals your breath. So that's why the show is called Poison Gas. And he's a mean-looking dude. Apocalypse Now.
So are these all posters?
Like prints. Posters if they're selling cheap, prints if they're selling expensive. So that these are A0 size. I don't know. What's the difference between a poster and a print? Not sure.
But like when you say Poison Gas was the title of the show, it would have been the poster for the show, or
it was an invite. That was I think I've got the image here. I'm not sure, but that was So the show was called Poison Gas, and that wasn't the poster for the show. No, it'd be difficult to send that out to people. Like my mum would get it. And she'd be like, why have you got a big penis? Why are you sending me images of a dick? What's wrong with you? My mum really doesn't like my work. She really doesn't. But you know, don't do what your mum says. I don't know why I did this one. So industrialized hostility, disintegration. And I don't know why there's massive wank fest of Iron Man. Really no idea. But I quite like it. Which is, all poets are fucked. Fundamentally true. Dismal hip scum. Woo! What happened?
Poison gas.
What happened there? Whoa, that was poison gas. So, tyrannical, masterless slavery. That's kind of pretty much the conditions we live under today. Fucked all the way up and down. USA! Rape, murder, suicide. yeah, I kind of like that, but not so much. This is an experiment. Okay. So, that was about 10 months ago. And things have got worse since then. So one of the things I thought I should show you was, so despite doing that, and despite, I don't know if it's here actually, wait a minute, let me see if I can find a magazine, come. Mag stuff, others, maybe, ooh, shite, maybe it's here. Okay, so this is this was an advert in Art Forum for a Rena Spalding's show. Rena Spalding's this very cool gallery in New York. They're great, actually, yeah? Emily and John. So yeah, this is the Tate Modern place. And come on, there you go. So this is Tate Modern, and so Merlin did a show about the cafe at this museum. And what he did was he basically remade a portion of the cafe in the gallery. So you went to the gallery and it was basically the Tate Museum's cafe. And they had an espresso machine and cups and books on shelves, just like, you know, like you would. Because they pissed him off. They basically had a show about pop art realism and he didn't want to be in it, and they put some of his work in it. It was all a fuck up. And the gallery basically also were complicit in the fuck up, so he made them pay. Really expensive show with no possible way of making any money. Anyway, and then he asked me to do, which is obviously part of the strategy, is to piss people off, is asked me to do, but it's also a nice thing to do. It's like, come on, Dan, do you want to make an advert in Art Forum? Yeah, fuck yeah. So this is Tate Modern, but I've renamed it Gallery Auschwitz. Which actually, if you think about it, is pretty bad. Bit of a risk, right? Okay? And because the idea is, we joke about this, that you know, this is where, you know, you incinerate artists, and it's just an awful place. But, so I did this, and it was kind of like, you know, well, that's probably going to be a bit risky, actually, in some ways. Then what happened, which is really funny, is that I got asked to do something called the image spread in this magazine called, oh for fuck's sake, what happened there? Why is it here? Oh yeah, I'm doing this bit. I think that's it. Oh no, it's this one. Okay. So, these were pages that I made for Text of Kunst. Come on. Why is it? Yeah. So, okay. So I got asked to do this. Like, Text of Kunst gives sort of several pages over to doing this image spread for artists, and they emailed me saying, hey, do you want to do this? And I was like, wow, that's really, it's kind of a big deal. It's kind of nice. I was really, like, humbled by that. And the editor sort of phoned me up and was like, okay, so I put you forward as the next one. Do you want to do it? And I'm like, yes, absolutely, 100%. Thank you very much. And then she sort of spoke about the conversation that they'd had in the editorial meeting, where she said, oh, I think Dan Mitchell should do this. And they were like, yeah, that's a good idea, yeah, do that. And she went, you know, that's the guy that did Tate Modern as Gallery Auschwitz. And I just think that's really funny. So take risks. Sometimes they blow up in your face and you look like a dick. And other times you get to do something. And this is, there's another backstory to this about working together with people that didn't go very well, but I haven't got time for that. So these are just kind of like dumb. Dumb ideas of people's faces involved in faking orgasms. So, like, for example, Feminism God Vagina, I was talking to a friend of mine, Inga. Well, Alina, her real name is, but Inga Copeland. And we were just walking down the street going la la la, and she went, oh yeah, like Feminism God Vagina. And I just thought, genius. I wrote it down and it became this. So it's important to, I always go over with a little notebook. If you don't, you should get into it. It's a good thing to do. You think you're going to remember it and you won't. So some of these were sort of edited out. Through my eyes, the spectacle is looking at you. That, I don't like that one. Don't like that one. Quite like, that was quite funny. White wine orgasm. Oh, I like a white wine. I like that one, but they didn't like that one. They didn't like that one. I can't remember if they like that one. They didn't like that one. I really like that one. They didn't like that. They did like that, but they wouldn't print it. And I think that men reproduce women is just, I don't know. You know, I consider myself to be a feminist urgent artist, so insurgent, urgent artist, urgent. I'm urgent, insurgent, feminist. Work, money, death. So some of these kind of like, you know, fall into sort of stereotypes or something. What time are we on now? It says 18. I don't know when you want to stop, because I could really go on forever, and people are already leaving, so. No response. Right. So, I'm going to finish on Hard Mag, but I'm just wondering if there's anything I could show you else. I know. Let's go up to date, yeah? I'll show you these two first. Okay, so this is probably, what's the date today? 29th?
Yeah.
It's a Wednesday.
Thursday. You're in Paris, yes.
So this happened in Paris 8 days ago. So I got it from the printer 1 week on Friday. So it's about 10 days old, these two images. So they're bang up today. Why is it turned into those fucking eggs? Okay. Right, okay. Go away. Come on. Yeah. Okay. Anyone speak French?
Yes.
What does it say? Translate for us, if you play.
Open your mind and the police will enter.
Yeah. So, there's two images, there are two people. First one is Johnny Depp, you know, the guy who plays, he's an actor. And then the guy behind him...
Mark Zuckerberg.
Yes! Fantastic, thank you. So, like, on the one hand, this one character is saying, hey man, like, smoking cigarettes, yeah, like, I fucking earn money and live in France and, like, I'm playing music with the Rolling Stones. And he's kind of like a very good-looking man, and he's cool, yes? He's cool. The other guy behind him is not cool. He's very, very rich, and he knows more about human beings than anyone else. He knows more about human beings than Freud Marx. Marx times Freud does not equal this guy, because he can see into the mind of over 1 billion people, right? If you run Facebook, the algorithms that are used to construct things like Google and Facebook are incredibly sophisticated. A few years ago, somebody dumped a whole load of search terms and search history from America online. This is about 8 years ago. And like millions and millions and millions of them. And they're probably still some floating around somewhere on the internet. Anyway, so, what it showed, and insurance companies have known this for a very long time, is that human behavior is incredibly predictable. You pretty much do the same thing, same time, every single day, in some way, or you have a rhythm. To the extent where the vast majority of people, you can predict what they're going to be doing to the day in 5 years' time, right? An insurance company, that's how they base their magic ratios about how much they charge for life insurance or car insurance or whatever. But he's got much more information than all the insurance companies put together. You know, 1 billion people commit online relatively personal information. Their behavior is online because they, you know, when they log on, when they log off, when they're doing this, when they're doing the things they look at, the things they're interested in, So the freedom image of like, yeah, it's like really good, yeah. And then the cop, kind of the same thing in many respects, or they're inextricably linked. Total lifestyle society. So she's bored or beautiful, or maybe that's the same thing. And it's just kind of like, whatever. Okay, so I'm going to finish on the next thing. So I know, I'm sorry I've taken quite a long time to get to the end, but we're going to finish on. So one of the things that I... But in 94 I stopped the studio. 97 I stopped the studio. I had to, it was getting really dangerous. I had a massive crack and heroin problem. That was 97. Basically, 2001 I stopped using drugs, I went to rehab, and I ended up in this place called Plymouth where I stayed for 4.5 years. Sometimes I have no idea why I did that. But anyway, I had this idea in 2000 and about making this thing called Hard Mag. It's about making a magazine that was kind of retarded and stupid and ugly and offensive on the one hand, but on the other hand was very, very serious. And it was a way of like being able to distribute my art to people cheaply, relatively cheaply. So, you know, you can buy a copy of Hard Mag for, it depends on which one it is, £5 or £10. This one is sold out. And it was this when this was 2004 was £5. Yeah, £5 or €8 in fact. Anyway, so I decided that I wanted something, and I remember an old situationist joke about magazines are where you keep your bullets. So a magazine is it's Arabic for shop, but it's also a magazine is a where you know the bullet, the thing you put in a gun, that's called a magazine. And a magazine hosts pages of ideas and images. And I just thought maybe it was quite an idea to start a magazine, see what would happen, you know, I don't know. And so I was in this pub with some friends of mine, and like one of our friends had just committed suicide, an artist who went totally crazy. And it was really sad and horrible. And we were having a drink in this pub, and this idea came into my head. I remember sort of speaking to my friends about it, and they were like, yeah, that's really stupid, you're retarded, fuck you, whatever. I remember going to the toilet going, they're wrong. And I remember coming out and just destroying absolutely their argument completely. And I remember going home thinking, and I wrote all this down on a bit of paper, which I subsequently lost, which was really stupid, because I think it was the... And it's like this whole idea of a trophy. I had this idea, and I've been working, trying to draw it out, trying to work towards it. You have an idea and you pursue it. You see it in your mind, but the reality is never going to be the same. And that trophy is kind of as good as it's going to get. Anyway, so Hard Mag, and so these are just some stupid pages from it. This is Plymouth. And that was kind of my experience in Plymouth. There were seagulls would attack you, and people would have sex in the street. And I mean, really have sex in the street. I remember walking home and seeing this couple fucking. And it was just, I was like, this is like some porn movie that's come to life. It was a kind of horrible place, actually. Don't ever go there. It's really dangerous. It's violent, but kind of weird.
Where is it?
Plymouth, southwest England. So burglary. So this first one is banned as well. The people who run this newspaper called the Evening Herald are called Northcliffe. They published big newspapers in the UK, and as soon as they saw this, they threatened to take me to court. That was bad. So this is from the first. That was the pilot. This is the first issue. So this is a photograph by an artist called Josephine Pride. Do you know?
Yes.
She's really good. Old friend of mine. So I asked Josephine. I gave her an assignment. And the assignment was that you should go shopping, but imagine yourself. It's all about capitalism, I guess. Like, you know, in many respects, that the way the images of people, and especially the images of women, are positioned in such a way to elicit certain responses and to encode things. And obviously Josephine, she's a feminist and she knows this, but the idea was that I said, look, can you go shopping and do something, take some photographs or whatever, but I want you to kind of like, imagine that you are like an enemy of what you're going into. Like, so imagine like, let's pretend that this is Berlin in 1940, and you are a British army officer, right? So that's not gonna feel very good, okay? You are the enemy inside something. So I just basically wrote this text and said, would you be this insurgent? Because she's a very cool, sophisticated person. Like, she once bought a dress on an aeroplane using the phone in the armrest. She was sitting on this plane reading Vogue, and she sort of went, oh, that's really nice, and she was going to an opening or something. So she then phoned up the shop in wherever it was and said, have you got this dress? And they said, yes, reserve that for me. I'll be landing in about an hour. I'll come pick it up. And I just thought that was really sexy. Like, you would sit on this plane, you'd look through a magazine and go, you know, because she always has Vogue, whatever. And she's like, yeah, and then she was like, yeah, I'll have the dress, thanks, see you soon, bye. Wow. I thought, wow. And that was, you know, like before, this is 2005, so we're talking about something that may have happened even before the internet.
What is this?
This is 2005. Anyway,
on the picture.
I'm getting to that. So what she did, this is fucking crazy, what she did is then she went to the supermarket and bought some fish. This is a cuttlefish. She bought cuttlefish, octopus, and squid. And then took them into the changing rooms of Topshop and did a photo shoot, right? With these fish. I was like, when she said, oh, I've done this in Chile, I was like, oh my God, it was incredible. So they, of course, were straight in. That's the cover. So this is the first issue. J.G. Ballard interview. Do you know who J.G. Ballard is?
Yeah.
If you don't, you should read J.G. Ballard, High Rise, Crash, Concrete Island, Supercans. Cocaine Nights. He's phenomenal. I love J.G. Ballard. I mean, I really. He was very important. So Jay Pride, Josephine Pride, Mark Dyer is an American cartoonist who got locked up for what he did. Karen Elliott is a lunatic. Johnny Wozlanski was sort of actually the Bernadette Corporation in disguise. So there's more. There's some squid. That's a poster. This is an interesting cover. So this was a student edition. I had the artwork printed up, and I was walking to show a friend of mine, because we were having the launch for this magazine in her studio in King's Cross in London, and I was walking past Gagosian Gallery, and they just happened to have an opening of Jeff Koons' Hulk paintings. So I know somebody who works, and I walked in and was like, oh, hi, Mark, yeah. And there's Jeff Koons in his little suit. And I went out and showed him this, and he went, that's exactly the right amount of testosterone. So, which I was then able to quote in the back of the magazine, which was really nice. So art school nightmare, this is about Satan being your art tutor. Drinking blood, making you take your clothes off, spanking you, doing all sorts of naughty, naughty. That's the back of the magazine. Thank you. So, I've made 10 of these, and I've got a few copies that will be available probably upstate, if that's okay. I'm sorry, I have to sell them to you because I've got no money at the moment. They might be expensive, but this is what it looks like. So this is the new one. I'll show you some images to finish with. I'm going to whip through this now because, okay, quickly. So this is an issue about hedge fund people who buy art. So the background here is a gallery in the East End, and these are city workers. Lots of money. And basically what's happening to this guy is his cock is talking to him, is telling him the truth. And his penis is saying to him, you used to explore psychology. Now I just stare at a bleak sham that is myself. And then underneath this is a sort of ultra left commentary on the credit crisis. So this is 2008. This is just as the credit crisis breaks, this is coming out. And then the same as you is this thing about snails. Snails have got a penis and a vagina. That's pretty good, right? And they fight each other, and they have these things called love darts that they fire at each other to determine who's going to be top and who's going to be bottom. I don't know if it's an S&M thing or just a gendered thing. But it's kind of interesting. They start out as that position and then have to fight to be able to say who's going to be mummy and who's going to be daddy. I dream of being eaten by a dog. very quickly, this is a catalogue. This is about Cologne and London. So the guy is an artist, a very old friend of mine, Kieran Kossler. There's a story in there by Mark von Schlegel. I haven't had any sleep for a couple of days, so I think I'm doing really well, but you might think I'm not. But then also, this is an attack against a critic who wrote about some of the things I was involved in Freeze. And so I took some of his text and then turned it into descriptions of mental illness. The sexist, this imagery here, was published by my grandfather. he made postcards in like a seaside town. In England, if you go to the seaside, there's this idea of like ice cream and sex and postcards. You haven't got a seaside here, have you?
No.
Oh, fuck. You should go to the seaside, it's amazing. So the seaside is like the edge of the country with water around it. And you go there and you take your clothes off and you go in the sea and you take children with you and it's really good. So my grandfather made the postcards, and these are kind of collages of the smutty postcards that he made. So it's all about mental illness and art criticism, basically. This is the cover of the one I did with a guy called Ed Lahan, amazing artist. So basically his idea for this was that if you imagine you're like about 17 and you're smoking the strongest weed you've ever smoked, that kind of basically is, as a metaphor, the closest you'll get to amazing freedom, endless freedom. After 17, you start getting responsibilities and start getting all fucked up. But 17, it's just like, when you start, you smoke this bong and anything is possible, so it's total freedom. And if you were to die at that moment, that is the welcoming committee in heaven. So that's the idea. That's the sort of how it started. And there's Scooby-Doo, Scooby-Doo, Scooby-Doo. These are Pope's missed one. Yeah, that's a poster. Another poster. So these are posters just to publicise the magazines. Eastern galleries in psycho torture. Another poster. Yeah, that's actually an opening, funny enough. At Gagosian. Oh yeah. Oh shit. Sorry, I don't know what you're doing. Sorry about that. Sorry about that. Yeah. Ooh. Yeah, this is about bourgeois sex famine. This one is about Rolls Royces torturing psychiatrists. That's bourgeois sex famine. That's a stall at a publishing fair. How did we get that there? Jesus Christ. Oh yeah, these are covers. Schittler. That's about shit and Hitler. Right, so I'm going to show you the last thing and then we can all run away. Where the fuck is it? Hardback War! So, the idea for this is about. So, this new hardback came out about a month ago. Prepare for War. So, it's basically about various different struggles. So, a friend of mine. Whoa, what happened there?
Go back to
preview. Oh my god. Oh yeah, 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 yeah. Can I have like that? Oh yeah. Right. So, this friend of mine, stop. Let's get these in order. Okay, so she did this performance piece where she reads out 30 examples of her getting fucked up on various substances and the consequence. And she's Welsh. So she speaks kind of like in a Welsh accent like this because she is Welsh. Once when I was cunted on Quaaludes, I stole a golf buggy and drove into oncoming traffic on the M4 to Glamorgan. Right? So she just reads out 30 of these. You know, and I was in the audience this thing, and I was like, God, that's fantastic. It was beautiful. It was absolutely fantastic. And so I said, look, can we do something with this? And so we made, I think, 12 pages or something. So you'll see that in the magazine, that it's sort of full page spread. But personally speaking as well, I'm sort of, the thing I'm exploring at the moment is layering one image over another. So you can see, so what you're seeing here is one image, another image, the text, and then the totality. So in one thing, there are four things. And I'm making it difficult for you. It's not an easy thing to look at. I don't know if you can work out. So that's Leonardo DiCaprio throttling Jonah Hill in Wolf of Wall Street. Thank you very much. But then this shape on the your left is a big black cock, and there's a vagina coming up here. So Leonardo DiCaprio is this kind of cock, and then he's this vagina, and they're sort of coming together. So it's kind of like quite appalling, right? It's quite bad, really. But then on the other hand, it's also very, very beautiful.
I thought the vagina was pierced because of the telephone string when I first saw it. If you look really quickly.
Well, you can see that. That probably says more about you than this. Oh, Christ, what's his name? He made Hostel. Green Inferno by Eli Roth is the image in the background. And in the front of this is Rear Window by Alfred Hitchcock. But I like this fragment. I like this difficulty. Right. And so the other part of the magazine is about destroying London. So these are, London is being re-engineered. So this building you're in at the moment, like if you're an architect, this is essentially, you have horizontal concrete floors and vertical concrete pillars, and then the whole thing is skinned in something called a curtain wall. It's very, very cheap to build. And the thing about concrete is it's really quite amazing as a substance. If you mix it properly, this floor could be here for 2,000 years, right? Because concrete as a substance only ever gets stronger. It's got an aggregate surrounded by a chemical that is very sharp, and the crystals that the when you mix the concrete together, this crystalline structure is produced that forces the points of the crystals around the aggregate, sand or pebbles or whatever, and it never stops. So this is this. Oh, that's metal. But here, this is only getting stronger, very slowly. Anyway, so they're rebuilding London at the moment, which is horrific because they're just killing people and it's my city, I live there and it's changing. You wouldn't believe it, it's just... Anyway, so the idea of this is that the Second World War comes back and they sort of start bombing London. And so this is the Japanese blowing up tapes. I seem to not really like Tate Modern blowing up. So, and these are kind of crude, stupid Photoshop jokes. I think. Hold on. Ooh. Shut up. Turn it off. Okay, the last, I know I said I wouldn't, but I'm going to show you one more thing. If I can find it. Right. Okay. This is going to be it. So you can relax. Okay? So when we get down to the serious stuff, like me as an artist, this is probably an example, a good example of me making something that I think is very, very good. Like the magazine stuff is good, it's very good, but this is kind of me taking things to a point where like I'm making an image to be very, very serious. I really, you know, if you said, what's your art? Yeah, magazine's art, what I opposed to. Thanks for coming. Have you got a flyer?
Yeah.
Oh, great, hope to see you there. So this is for me an example of, so this would be a print skinned onto aluminium or framed and then sold to rich people, hopefully. So I can't remember like this collector in Stuttgart bought this, I think. I can't remember how much he paid for it. Not very much. I mean, he probably paid about 4,000 or 5,000 euros for this. Which is not much, right? And that took me a long time to make. It was difficult and a lot of thinking. But I don't have any money at all. But so that's and it's part of a series.
Does it have a title?
Huh?
Does it have a title?
Yeah, this one is called Egoist. It's essentially about the myth of Daedalus, who was the father of Icarus. This one is called, I can't remember now, I can look it up. Essentially this is about weakness, this one. So this is an image from a film, although that's my face, they're all self-portraits. This is from a film called Sunset Boulevard, and it starts with a hero being shot and stumbling into a swimming pool. And it's an amazing shot from inside the swimming pool, looking up at this actor, I forgot his name now. But he's floating in this pool like this, and the camera, the shot is coming up here. And that's how the film opens. If you haven't seen it, it's really worth seeing. The interesting thing is that when they made that shot, they couldn't get the camera right underwater. So they needed to increase the focal length. And what they did was they put a mirror on the bottom of the swimming pool, had the camera up here, shooting down into the water and then coming up again. So I really like that. And these are late Manet, the paintings. I think Manet's, well, I don't know if he's one of my favorite, but definitely one of my favorite artists. And these are the late paintings that he made as he was dying from syphilis, which is an illness that you got from, sort of like the, you know, the 19th century AIDS or something, I guess. I mean, it was pretty, you know, they didn't have penicillin there, so you just died. It was horrible death. Horrible. And these hands and these sort of monsters sort of ripping things away. I mean, part of me doesn't know what I've done here. I don't know. You know, and it's one of the interesting, I'm 48, it's one of the interesting things as I'm making work that I probably won't really get to see or understand its full impact. Because it takes about 30 years to do that. Really. If you're serious, it can take 30 years. So if I live for another 30 years, which would be fucking great, but with my history, kind of probably not going to happen. But, you know, I look after myself today, a bit. So for those of you who are like going to be drug addicts, there is hope for you, but, you know. And that's me as Manet, it's Manet's beard. And these are scenes from a really cracking film called The Bling Ring. Anyone seen that?
Yeah.
Sofia Coppola's great. And so we've got teens in bed, love teens in bed. You can't quite see it on this, but she's got a tattoo on her lip that says, fuck you. Cocaine. Dancing in nightclubs. Texting. Cocaine again. Selfies and money. So it's sort of. I guess the arrows are kind of desire. Look, I want money. I want teens in bed. I kind of mind a fuck you lip tattoo as well. Cocaine, dancing in nightclubs. You know, whatever. But somehow these are kind of broken up, obscured by all these women going. So, I don't know. But I'm not sure, I don't know. I mean, you might not like it. This is one. I went to this party and took these photographs of people. It's a really difficult thing. When I take photographs of people, they kind of look, the images I get are people looking really kind of scared and suspicious. You know, it's like. What the fuck? There was an artist called Wyndham Percy Lewis, who's a British futurist, deeply unpleasant man, quite a good artist for a while. Ernest Hemingway said of him, he had the look of an unsuccessful rapist, which is not a good look. Probably better than another, anyway. But when I take photographs of people, they sort of go, what are you going to do with that? And they kind of go, ooh. Whereas if you're kind of like charming, beautiful, you know, people, and you take photographs, then everyone goes, oh, they're taking my photograph, what are you going to do with that? Oh, that's so cool, hi, do I look my best? Whereas that's not the response. I get kind of angry, what the fuck? But I try to use that to my advantage in this. But this actually is also a recreation of a very famous painter called, it's actually just there in that computer. It's Christ, the point of it, what's his name?
Charles Sura.
Sura? Sura, of course, the island of the island on Sunday afternoon, whatever. Everyone's promenading around. So this is my kind of equivalent of La Promenade. Also, weirdly enough, that this will feature at the opening that you hopefully all going to be coming to. So there's an invite. This finally was. I used to manage this band called The Male Nurse, and some really great people in it. Some are dead, some are still alive. One of them is an artist called Keith Farquhar. And he's a great, really great friend of mine. And he was talking about something once, and I couldn't really understand what he was saying, couldn't really hear him. And I thought he said, black guy's an abstract painting. So I just thought, wait a minute, like, that's really great, what the f-? Anyway, so I then, this is about myths, and two American myths. So one, the first American myth is the black police detective. And so these black police detectives are apprehending American abstract expressions in the course of their crimes. So you've got Will Smith, Christ, what's his name?
Franz Klein.
Mark Rothko, Jackson Pollock, Barnett Newman, etc., etc. Anyway, I think I'm going to leave it there because I'm really, really tired and I don't want to bore you or keep you from your lives any longer. But I'd just like to say thank you very much and make sure you come along to this, which is going to be, this is me with another artist who lives in Zurich, Bea, and she's fantastic. And we met in London, and it was just one of those things that it was like, I wasn't going to go to this event, but I thought, fuck it, it was about skateboarding. And I'm like, you know, I skateboarded a while ago, like a lot, like, if you see me on a skateboard, just say, get off the fucking skateboard. Because when I fall off a skateboard, it's going to really hurt me. So don't let me go on a skateboard. But I like skateboarding, although I can't really do it. The ollie thing never really happened to me. But I can ride a bowl, I can, you know. when you're doing that, if you ever want to do that, you move the body and let the board follow. If you do it the other way around, you are going to fall off. Isn't that right?
Probably.
But so we've got this show upstate, and it's called Nasty Gold, because we were going to call it Nazi Gold, but we kind of thought that probably wasn't going to go down so well. So Nasty Gold is probably better. But I don't know what else to say. I'm just going to shut up. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.